everyone. I'm Michelle Long. It's 9 in Manila, 10 in Tokyo, and 9 p.m. in New York. The headlines. The Philippine Central Bank expected to keep its tight monetary policy unchanged today, even after more expensive food and transport costs caused inflation to tick higher for second month in March. Some houses now expect the rate cuts to begin later towards the end of the year. We speak with Moody's Analytics' Steve Cochrane for his thoughts. In equities, Asian markets seen trading up at the start of the week. That will see several central banks handing down policy decisions from the Philippines to Israel to New Zealand to Canada and then the Eurozone. For the day, the PSE index kicking off from 67.45 after falling on Friday and last week. It seems like resorts are off to a great start this summer. Listed Boulevard Holdings reports it's Friday's Puerto Galera Resorts saw sales more than quadruple in March, bringing its total sales for the 10-month period ending March to 26.5 million pesos, double the amount it made the same period the year before. And later, find out whether the franchising business model is for you and how you can protect yourself from scams. JP Morales, president of the Association of Filipino Franchisers, joins us later on the show. We begin with stocks. Asian markets expected to kick off this week on a high note as investors choose to focus on strong economic numbers rather than how these numbers could delay rate cuts by the Federal Reserve. China, too, is coming back online today after a two-day break from last week. So let's take a look at the numbers here. So far, the Nikkei 225 outperforming, up 1%. ASX up by a tenth. The Kospi Index feeling some pressure, down by a fifth. We did say that China is coming back online, so we're expecting a lot of attention on China's daily yuan reference rate after the currency weakened towards a so-called no-go zone last week. Now, any signs of fixing could be taken as a signal whether Beijing will support its currency more vigorously this time around or perhaps allow for some moderate depreciation. Let's take a look at contracts for U.S. futures. Looking mixed, very close to the flat line, but the S&P and the NASDAQ are expected to feel some downward pressure, while the Dow Jones could see slightly upward pressure when trading resumes tonight over in the U.S. We do remember that both the S&P and the NASDAQ indexes are coming from an over 1% advance last Friday. Elsewhere, when you look at commodities, oil retreated after six straight sessions of gains, while gold is slipping this morning after surging to records last week. Now, here's a recap of what happened. Last week on Wall Street, U.S. stocks finished higher last Friday after a strong jobs report reinforced the view that the U.S. economy remains healthy, even as it suggested that the Federal Reserve could delay cutting interest rates.
We gained 303,000 jobs in the month of March, and unemployment rate fell to 3.8%. These were, by any measure, knocking it out of the park type of performance by the American labor market. This is implying that American economy is strong and resilient despite the rate hikes that we've seen in the last 2 years. Earlier in trading, the equity markets were down with the expectation that the Fed, seeing a strong economy, would keep the rates higher for longer. And bond yields shot up with the same expectation. Now, during the day, that reversed, and stock market decided that this was actually good news.
So, U.S. stocks advanced with big tech leading the rebound. The S&P 500 up 1.1%, snapping a two-day drop. As you can see, the NASDAQ outperformed major benchmarks with Google's parent Alphabet Inc. and Microsoft climbing at least 2.5% each. Now, bonds traded mixed while the U.S. dollar barely budged last week. Traders got a respite after Federal Reserve Bank of St. Louis President James Bullard said he doesn't think tighter credit conditions stemming from the recent banking turmoil will tip the U.S. economy into a recession. But still, you know, uncertainties over rate cuts and when they'll actually happen have put many traders on hold. Back here at home, here's a quick look at the local corporate headlines we're watching this morning. Very quiet on the disclosures front still. We're getting a lot of buyback transactions, but here's one interesting from Boulevard Holdings. It seems like resorts are off to a great start this summer. Listed Boulevard Holdings reporting it's Friday's Puerto Galera Resort. So this is only coming from the operations of one of its resorts out of several. At least that results in Puerto Galera saw more than sales, more than quadruple in March to 5.8 million pesos, bringing its total sales for the 10-month period ending March 31 to 26.5 million pesos. That is double the amount they made year on year. Did you know that in 2022, the franchising industry contributed around 8% to the country's GDP and generated roughly 2 million direct and indirect jobs? Food and beverage franchises contributing 80% of this revenue, bringing in more than $10.8 billion. That's according to the Trade Department, while non-food retail and services each delivered 10% to the total valued at $1.34 billion. Now, the estimate is that the Philippines is actually the seventh largest franchise market in the world and the largest in the Southeast Asian region. Joining us now for more on this, JP Morales, president of the Association of Filipino Franchisers. JP, hi. Welcome to Market Edge.
Hi, Mimi. Good morning to everyone watching. Thank you so much for having me here today.
All right. So, JP, for those who are wondering, how did you get into the franchising business? How many franchises do you actually own? And how are you doing?
Yes, well, actually, back in 2017, when I was still a college student, I started my very first business. That was Teriyaki Ice Cream. Then later on, I developed my business into the franchising business. And then that was the first time I ventured into franchising. Then I met this association. It's called Association of Filipino Franchisers, Inc. And that's where I started my very first franchising industry business model as well. Currently, our association has 180 members, and my business, Righty and Choco Monkey, we currently have 40 outlets nationwide. That's for Righty and 2 outlets for Choco Monkey here in NCR.
All right. And all of these are using the franchising model.
Yes, yes, Mimi.
All right. So let's talk about the industry itself. Everybody says there is a huge franchising opportunity, especially for a domestic-driven economy where 99.9% of establishments are SMEs. What is the opportunity according to you? And do you think there are typical, characteristics to the Philippines that make us more inclined to this business model?
Yes, Mimi, actually, the Philippines is a home to multiple franchise businesses. If you have noticed, in every corner, there's a franchise outlet present. In fact, 68% of the establishments are into franchising. Now, the opportunities into franchising is very big. For example, if you want to expand your business across nationwide, the best way to be able to expand your business is through franchising. With the right franchising system model, you will be able to hit your target market. And of course, the franchisees will be able to earn more with that franchise model.
Mm-hmm. But what are the challenges, though? I mean, do franchises typically do better, or are they typically more resilient during economic slowdowns?
Well, actually, Mimia, the pandemic has proven that the franchise model is the best way if you will be venturing into business, especially if you're a first-time business owner. The franchisor has already established the franchise system or the business model itself, even the systems. It's what they call this the pandemic proof already. It was a test to all franchisors how resilient they are, and also how can they be able to establish their franchise into the pandemic time. Now, if you use a franchise, ito talaga yung pinaka-best model na hindi ka maloloko dahil these franchisers are talagang legitimate franchisers.
Mm-hmm. Let's get to the word legitimate there. I know that you have a program where you sort of give certifications to be able to protect franchisees and eliminate scam. Tell us more about this. I mean, first of all, what and how would you consider a franchise model a scam? Because we know of so many big brands, big, reliable, trusted brands, where according to the franchisees, only the brand owner wins. And the franchisees feel, we're just working for the brand owner talaga. Eventually, we lose money in our own venture. How would you define a scam franchise model?
All right. Okay, Mimi. So let me first share what the franchise practitioner we are giving. It's called the Certified Franchise Practitioner. It's the CFP. Now, this is in support of the Executive Order 169, which is strengthening the franchising industry for the protection of the small and medium enterprises. Now, this Certified Franchise Practitioner, the CFP, while it aims to certify, legitimize, promote franchisers the responsible way of practicing a franchise and eliminate the scam franchisers. Alam mo, this certification process involves a series of modules attended by franchisers, wherein the educators of the model are franchise practitioners, not only from the academe side, but from the practitioners themselves. Now, this certified program is made by the homegrown franchisers and for the homegrown franchisers here in our country. Now, through this initiative, the CFP, the legitimate franchisers will be given a certified franchise practitioner title at the end of their name to signify that the franchisor is legitimate and has undergone series of modules and practices responsible franchising, which informs the public that the franchisor is a legitimate franchise practitioner. Now, going back, the question was, sabi nila, yung franchisee, hindi kumikita, only the franchisor. Well, actually po kasi it boils down po, with the right computation. If the computation, minsan kasi pag mali ang computation ng franchisee, akala nila yung franchisor lang kumikita. Let me give you an example, Mimi. For example, we had this franchisee before, ang lakas ng sales niya. So, bili siya na bili ng supplies. Ang sabi niya sa akin, JP, bakit parang hindi ako tako kumikita? Now, nung tinignan namin yung kanyang accounting, mali yung kanyang computation. Hindi niya na itatago yung kanyang income. Akala minsan kasi ng franchisee, yung sales, yun na yung kanilang kita. Hindi po. Yung sales, hihiwalayin pa natin dyan yung cost of goods. Then doon natin madedetermine yung ating net income or yung net profit ng franchisee. I think those are some of the mistakes na nasasabi ng franchisee na hindi kami kumikita, si franchisor lang kumikita.
Mm-hmm. So going back to the CFP, the Certified Franchise Practitioner. So, do you also do background checks on their business models, or as long as they attend your course, they get that CFP and they're automatically considered legit?
Okay, but for this one, Mimi, we have first to make due diligence. So we have to first interview the franchisor, the brand owner. Then we have to check their commissary. We have to check their papers. Do they have the business permit? Do they have the BIR permit? Do they have the mayor's permit, the barangay clearance, and all the health certificates and all the FDA? We have to ensure na talagang legitimate sila. And even pumupunta po kami sa kanilang outlets na dinideclare nila dun sa kanilang application form. And then, of course, once they pass, they have first to be a member of the association before they can get the Certified Franchise Practitioner module.
All right. And you did say that your group currently has 180 members. Is that correct? Give us a sense. Would that be 80% of the total franchising universe for the Philippines?
Well, for the Philippines, actually, that's roughly around... let's say 70 to 80% of the franchising industry.
70 to 80%. So the big brands are members of your group?
Yes, for the homegrown brands like Shaw My House, we have Tokyo Tempura, Goto King, Taters. Those are some of the big brands that we have in our association.
I wonder, JP, why did you come up with this program, the CFP program? You must have seen something. You must have heard stories from franchisees. How big is the scam universe for franchising industry in the Philippines? Just very curious.
Yes, well, back in the days, people have been prying on are the OFWs, because these OFWs have been outside of our country and doesn't know much about our franchising industry in this country. So what I have discussed with my fellow boards, sabi ko, ano yung pwede natin gawin to protect them? So this is where the CFP came up. Sabi namin, ano bang objective namin with the CFP? The objective is to protect the public and the franchisees from getting a franchise scam, to educate them about the franchising industry, and of course, the homegrown franchisers to be educated on the responsible franchising using their franchise model, and to easily distinguish a legitimate franchisor, and of course, to eliminate those scam franchisers. Now, of course, to a story, back in 2018, I had this business partner. Well, sabi niya before, JP, I bought a franchise bago tayo nagkakilala. Sabi ko, what was that franchise? It was a burger franchise. On the day of his opening, alam mo, sabi sa kanya, wala kami maibibentang burgers sa'yo. You have to buy your own burgers outside. You go to the wet market, hanap ka ng buns and patties. Well, that's not how franchising works. Franchising works is the franchiser delivers you his supplies or
so
you buy the supplies.
So it's product distribution, yes.
Yes, yes. So sabi ko, you got scammed. You got so how much did you bought that franchise? Sabi niya, it's cheap. It's only 129,000 pesos. So sabi ko, as halagang 29,000 pesos, na loko ka, na scam ka. And of course, there are also some OFWs na bumili sila ng franchise no, habang sila nasa abroad. Then pag uwi nila dito, wala pala yung kanilang franchise. So na-scam sila, na loko sila. So sabi ko, nakakaawa naman itong mga tao na to dahil these are the people who work hard to earn that money and to buy that franchise at umaasa sila na meron silang kikitain sa franchise na kanilang kinuha.
Mm-hmm. And the CFP that you put at the end of the names of those who have passed this module, for example, is CFP officially recognized by government agencies, perhaps like the DTI?
Well, yes, we are partnering with the Department of Trade and Industry. Well, actually, Mimi, just a short story, you know. When we were coming up with the Certified Franchise Practitioner, I asked for the guidance of former Secretary Mon Lopez in creating this one. I told the former Secretary Mon that we're creating the CFP program and how we can help other people, you know, to distinguish what a legitimate franchisor looks like and, of course, how we can protect the franchising industry since there's already the Executive Order 169, the strengthening the franchising industry for the protection of micro, small, and medium enterprises.
Mm-hmm. Final question, JP. What is your visibility for the franchising business model for 2024? Is it mighty hard to attract people into the model when you've got a high interest rate, high inflation, slowing growth environment like this? Or is it easier?
Well, what we can see, you know, for this year, there will be an increase of double digit in the franchising industry this year, as we have seen that there are a lot of franchisers, first-time franchisers here in our country, especially during the pandemic. There are those who venture their business into a franchising industry. And as the Filipinos, I think we are very resilient. And I have seen that talagang gusto nilang pumasok sa the franchising industry.
Ano ang mas marami, JP? Yung mga may bagong negosyo na gustong i-franchise out yung brand? Or those who like OFWs and those who want a sideline, who want to become franchisees? Saan
well,
mas
actually,
marami?
Well, based on experience ng Mimi, I think mas marami yung mga gusto magtayo ng kanilang business into the franchising industry.
All right. And on that note, JP, thank you so much for joining us this morning and for sharing with us stories from the ground and for what you do to help our SMEs scale and to give opportunities for Filipinos who want more opportunities to earn a living. Thank you again for the time and the insights. Have a great week ahead.
Thank you, Mimi. Thank you so much for having me.
All right. Now, moving on to other news. The government task force warns the whole country will feel the effects of the El Niño phenomenon by the end of this month. Nearly 20 local governments have declared a state of calamity due to the weather phenomenon, with the agriculture damage climbing to at least 2.63 billion pesos. The task force expects more provinces to be affected by El Niño. It's now urging the public to conserve and reduce their water consumption.
The end of April, 80 out of the 82 provinces, more or less, meron ng epekto yung El Nino sa kanya. Pero hindi ibig sabihin nun na lahat ng sakahan mapipinsala, lahat ng water reservoir o yung sources of water ay matutuyo. Pero dahil nga sa init na nararanasan natin, kahit papano masasabi nating apektado na yung buong bansa. O ipagpaliban po muna yung maintenance at saka yung paglilinis po ng swimming pools hanggat maaari. Again, pakiusap po ito, hindi po ito pagbabawal. Pero po kasi talaga kapag maglinis tayo kahit ng isang swimming pool, napakalaking konsumo po nun sa tubig.
Meanwhile, the Philippine Budget Department has released 4.5 billion pesos for the crop insurance premium. of nearly 2.3 million farmers and fisher folks in the country. The agency also issued a notice of cash allocation for the first quarter of the year, totaling 900 million pesos to the Philippine Crop Insurance Corporation, or PCIC. The DBM says the assistance will help the country's agriculture workers safeguard their means of livelihood despite ongoing issues like the El Nino phenomenon. PCIC's primary mandate is to provide insurance protection to farmers against losses from natural calamities and pest infestations, among others. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. earlier assured farmers of heightened government support in ensuring sustainable harvest. The Agriculture Department, meanwhile, ruling out imposing another price cap on regular and well-milled rice, saying it would rather focus on increasing production and lowering costs. Based on government data, rice was the biggest contributor to the upward trend in inflation, which rose for a second month in March to 3.7%. The staple saw a 24.4% inflation, that is a 15-year high. But the agency notes, while year-on-year, the price of rice has gone up, month-on-month, figures have actually been trending lower. Meanwhile, agriculture damage due to El Nino is now estimated at 2.63 billion pesos. Now remember, back in 2023, President Marcos, who then was still holding the agriculture portfolio, had imposed a one-month price cap on rice, a move that was heavily criticized. Shifting gears now, Philippine authorities appealing to fugitive televangelist Apollo Quiboloy to surrender and face charges. The Philippine National Police says they're already coordinating with various law enforcement agencies to monitor Quiboloy's whereabouts. The PNP also assures the pastor of his safety, adding his sexual and child abuse charges are all bailable.
We believe na nandito po siya sa Pilipinas or nasa Davao region pa po siya. Meron na pong directive, hindi lang sa Piero 11.
Yes.
Including other units, kagaya ng nabanggit niyo po, like sa HPG, sila po maglilid ng convoy ng transportation hanggang Davao International Airport. And then from Manila naman po, Manila International Airport hanggang sa Senate po.
Now, Quiboloy on Saturday denied he is in hiding. He insisted he only wants to protect himself against extradition. The pastor also issued conditions before surrendering to authorities. He said he will face any courts as long as the president and the secretary of justice will make a written guarantee the U.S. will not meddle in his case. Quiboloy has been on the FBI's most wanted list for a series of cases, including sex trafficking and bulk cash smuggling.
Kasi ang gusto po nila ay rendition, yung extraordinary rendition, at mayroon pa po akong patong na 2 milyong dolyares sa ulo ko. Ibig sabihin, 110 milyon pesos si Marcos mismo at ang FBI at CIA. Nagkasundo na po na ako'y ibigay sa kanilang kamay. Ibigay ni Marcos ako sa kamay ng mga puti. Hindi ako magpapahuli ng buhay. Barilin na lang ninyo ako.
Now here's a look at the other stories we're tracking in the newsroom today. Happening within the hour, President Marcos will inspect and lead the energization of the third stage of the Cebu Negros Panay Backbone Project in Bacolod City. While at 10, we cover the AMRO ASEAN Plus 3 Regional Economic Outlook Briefing. And at 1 this afternoon, the Land Transportation Franchising and Regulatory Board will hold a press conference on transport-related issues. And of course, big day for finance reporters. At 3 p.m., the Philippine Central Bank will conduct its Monetary Board policy meeting with a projected hold on interest rates even after inflation quickened again in March. We're taking a quick break. Up next, the opening numbers with CL Financial's Head of Institutional Sales, Adrian Yu. Market Edge. We'll be right back. You're still watching Market Edge. The headlines: the Philippines, the U.S., Australia, and Japan hold their first joint drills in the West Philippine Sea. China responding with its own combat patrols in the South China Sea. And Israel reduces its presence in southern Gaza with fresh talks for ceasefire set to begin. The PSE index kicking off from 67.45 after falling another 1.2% last Friday as inflation heated up again for the month of March. Regionally, markets mostly fell too amid rate uncertainties and heightened geopolitical tensions in the Middle East. Joining us now to help get you set up for this week, another shortened trading week, is Adrian Yu of COL Financial, Head of Institutional Sales. Adrian, good morning. Thanks so much for taking our call.
Good morning, Mimi. Thanks for having me.
All right. So we opened this week with a Philippine Central Bank's rate decision that happens at 3 p.m. today, right after the closing bell. And we're going to be leading a string of rate announcements from the Euro area, Canada, New Zealand, Thailand, and Israel. Is this a non-event for the markets, you think? I mean, coming from last Friday's March inflation print, it seems like the print falling below 3% might be a blip, and headline inflation might go back up to about 4% this Q2. What are your thoughts on this?
Well, I think the market was slightly surprised globally that inflation is proving to be a little stickier than what markets would have hoped. And I think this is changing the course for what path the interest rates might take for the remainder of the year. So I think what we're likely going to see is that the BSP and the US Fed might end up pausing rates for longer before eventually cutting rates later in the year. So I think that's what's potentially putting a cap to our markets rally here in the local market.
Mm-hmm. All right. So we're pausing for longer. So when are you now pricing in the first rate cut to happen, and how deep will the cuts be for the totality of 2024?
Well, I think for the BSP, we'll have to see what the US Fed will do. I don't think the BSP will take a very aggressive stance on potentially cutting rates earlier. So we're still looking at potentially 50 to 75 bips, and we think that the BSP will keep in lockstep. So if the US Fed cuts in July, that's the earliest we're potentially looking at for a BSP rate cut as well.
Okay, and what are you looking at for the Fed rate cut? July? Is July the month?
Initially, we're looking at July, but potentially we could see it push back potentially one session later with the Minneapolis Fed, in fact, saying that questioning whether or not a rate cut might even be prudent this year. So I think there's a downside risk to potentially also for the U.S. Fed to delay the cut one cycle later.
All right. I want to pull up our calendar now for this week. We know it's a shortened trading week for traders out there. We have no trade tomorrow and Wednesday. Araw ng Kagitingan plus Eid al-Fitr, of course. So for Philippines, it's only Monday, Thursday, Friday, but we're getting a lot of data coming out aside from central banks. We're supposed to get jobs numbers on Wednesday, but that could be moved because it's a holiday. Thursday, we're getting trade numbers. That's export, imports, and deficit, plus industrial production. Anything else in the calendar for this week that excites you, that you think could prove to be a catalyst, whether to the downside or the upside?
Well, right now, I think as far as local news is concerned, I don't think the market at this point should react to anything more significantly, considering we already had the inflation print and then the U.S. jobs number last week. I think those two have already dictated the path of the U.S. Fed and BSP quite to a significant degree. So I think for the remainder of the week, what we're rather looking at is to see how the market will react to this news that has already been priced in the market. We're trying to see if potentially our local market can in fact hold 6-7 support. If the market cannot hold this, we'll have to see potentially a deeper cut. But for now, I think the base case is that the local market should be able to defend this support.
All right, defend this support at 6-7. Adrian, when you look at the earnings that we've seen from Q4, from these listed companies, the pronouncements they've made so far, and their CapEx plan for this year, or maybe even when you do your analyst calls or briefings, what is the sense that you're getting from these listed companies about how they might feel about their own inflation experience and their inflation expectations moving forward? What sense are you getting? Could you share that with us?
Well, I think for a variety of sectors, I think when you look at their fourth quarter numbers, you'll see that the range varies, but within the sector, it's quite consistent. So when you look at the banking sector, we saw that fourth quarter numbers were still strong across the board. When you check the property segment, those with have a higher exposure to malls did quite better than those with a higher exposure to resi. And when you look at consumer companies, you can see those with the pricing power or those with the ability to price higher tended to do better than those who are in general price takers. So when you look at them across the board in the first quarter guidances for this year and their CapEx expectations, when we look at them, we tend to see that those who did well in the fourth quarter are probably still the ones who are expected to do better largely for the remainder of the year as the as inflation expectations still remain the same. So I think you should focus or investors should focus on those who did well in the fourth quarter and who are still poised to do better for the remainder of the year.
All right. Just very quickly, we're 7 minutes into trade for the day, and the index is so far lagging behind. We're underperforming our peers. The index is down by a tenth of 1%, 8 points. We're at 67.37. You did say that the challenge is to see whether we can defend the 6,700. I think we're now ready for your blind item. Talk to us about the stock that you're monitoring closely and that you like. Don't tell us. Just describe and review your to guess what this is. So what do you have for us today?
So for today, I have a banking stock. It has silently outperformed the market. It's already up 18% for the year, significantly outperforming the broad index. This was brought about by the strong earnings in the fourth quarter, driven by double-digit loan growth. But what's exciting for us is that this company is actually trading amongst the best amongst its peers in terms of its return on equity while trading at below book or their cheap valuations. And what's exciting for us is that compared to most traditional issues trading at a significant discount, its earlier price action for the start of the year leads us to think that this might not be like the rest of the companies who have been experiencing a value trap, considering the price momentum we've seen for the start of the year. And we're expecting this stock to potentially narrow the discount further and rally some more to end the year.
To rally some more, how much more? I mean, you did say it's already up 18% for the year.
Well, our preliminary target is seeing another 20%, but I think we can potentially exceed this in the near term.
Huh. All right. On that note, thank you very much, Adrian. We're going to have to guess which stock this is. Always a pleasure speaking with you. Have a great week ahead.
Thanks, Mimi. Thanks for having me.
All right. Time now to zip through the top headlines from major business papers. Let's start with the business world. La Vista-led Solar Philippines Power Project and its partner in Indonesia, Medco Energy, have signed a $14 million or 792 million peso loan deal for a 25-megawatt solar farm project in eastern Bali. The implementation of the solar project actually started last year and is estimated to cost some $20 million and is funded by a combination of Bank Negara's credit facility and equity invested by Medco and Solar Philippines. All in all, the joint venture of Solar Philippines and Medco in Bali have a capacity of up to 50 megawatts, with plans to energize the first 25 by the end of this year and the next 25 scheduled by 2025. From the Philippine Daily Inquirer, while digital banks continue to outperform traditional banks in attracting deposits, their bad loans are also on the rise. BSP data show the digital banks' non-performing loans ratio, or NPL, these are borrowings that are more than 90 days late on a payment, actually accounted for 21.6% of its total loan book, slightly higher than the 20.9% ratio back in January. Now for context, that's equivalent to around 4.9 billion pesos in bad loans and is more than six times larger than the 3.44% NPL ratio of the entire local banking industry. And from Business Mirror, Bicol Sado Party List Representative Brian Raymond Yamsuan renewing calls for the revival of the Bicol Express Rail Line, urging government to explore again the possibility of having Japan fund the stalled project. Yamsua notes Japan continues to offer highly concessional financing packages to the Philippines for infrastructure projects, including one for the Metro Manila subway. For this line in particular, the estimated cost of the first phase of the reconstruction, known as the South Long Haul Project, is approximately worth 142 billion pesos. President Marcos seeking to address traffic woes in the Philippines. In his latest vlog, Marcos says traffic congestion is among the country's pressing problems, which he says places the country in a very bad light. Marcos also blaming Filipinos' supposed lack of road discipline for the congestion. He says government officials should be an example when it comes to being disciplined drivers and pedestrians. The president also underscoring the importance of provincial development to solve traffic woes in the metro.
Traffic ang isa sa pinakamatindi nating problema dito sa bansa. Nakakalungkot man ay isa na itong bahagi ng pamumuhay ng bawat Pilipino at hindi rin natin mapagkaila na kanyag o notorious na sa buong mundo ang traffic dito sa Pilipinas. Congested ang Metro Manila, kung kaya bahagi talaga ng pagpaplano ay may develop ang mga kalapit probinsya at siyudad. Ang higit na kakulangan nating mga Pilipino sa daan ay ang disiplina. Dapat susunod tayo sa traffic rules para tayong mauubusan lagi ng kalye.
Now, motorists bracing for another big-time oil price increase this week. Pilipinas Shell kicking off those hikes, announcing that gasoline will be going up by 1 peso and 10 centavos per liter, kerosene by 1 peso and 40 centavos per liter, while diesel will see the biggest jump of 1 peso and 55 centavos per liter. Meanwhile, oil prices fell more than a dollar a barrel on Monday, with the Brent sliding under $90 as Middle East tensions eased after Israel withdrew more soldiers from southern Gaza and committed to fresh talks on a potential ceasefire in the six-month conflict. The BSP is tipped to keep benchmark interest rates steady at a near 17-year high of 6.5% this week amid lingering inflation risks. For more on his BSP outlook, Moody's Analytics' Steve Cochrane joins us live. Steve, hi, good morning, good to see you.
Good morning. Good to see you. Thanks.
So, Steve, we're coming from 2 months of inflation uptick here in the Philippines. Does this change fundamentally the narrative of the central bank for you?
I don't think it changes it too much. I think what's important to realize is that when you look deeper in the numbers, they're, in a sense, kind of all over the place. You look at top line inflation up to 3.7% up over the last 2 months. But when you look at core inflation, which excludes food and non-alcoholic beverages and such, core inflation actually came down in February, down to 3.4 from 3.6 a month prior. Also, one of the real problems with inflation is rising food prices. The food component of the CPI has really been rising strong, and a lot of this has to do with rising prices of rice. Weather hasn't been so favorable. It's been tough. And actually, in a sense, there's not a whole lot the central bank can do about that. And so I think still the central bank is kind of going to remain on pause for a while and wait to see a more consistent downward trend while the economy hopefully continues to grow at a fairly steady pace.
Mm-hmm. So you're not expecting a further uptick in inflation, because you did say the BSP will likely stay on pause to wait to see more consistent downward trends. You're not expecting any consistent upward trend.
You know, if there's an upward trend in inflation, it's going to come from food prices. And that has been the major problem for taming inflation throughout much of Southeast Asia over the last 3 to 4 months. And again, a lot of food price, the food price inflation can't be controlled by interest rates. And so the Fed, the BSP, pardon me, will be probably looking more at the core inflation rather than that top line number that's still going up.
Huh. All right. So we are expecting another pause. It would be the fourth straight meeting for the BSP to keep rates unchanged since the 25 bips off-cycle hike last October. What are you penciling in? When do you expect maybe the first rate cut to happen? Is it going to be more dependent on the Fed's narrative, or is it going to be local core inflation numbers that's going to direct it more?
Well, I think it's both. I tend to agree with Adrian, who was on a few moments ago, that the Fed has to be looking over its shoulder, the BSP has to be looking over its shoulder at the Fed, because the BSP doesn't want that spread between local interest rates and U.S. interest rates to widen. And so they probably won't move until the Fed moves, and then how fast the BSP moves will depend on will be dependent on what's going on with inflation in the Philippines.
All right. So when are you expecting the Fed to make its first move?
Boy, it's a good question, isn't it? With the jobs numbers that came out last week, very, very strong. We've got a three-month moving average of like 279,000 jobs a month. Big, big, good, strong numbers. So the labor market is very strong. The economy is very healthy in the U.S. And the downward trend in inflation has stopped. You know, the inflation was coming in second half of last year, but we turned the corner into 2024. And inflation has been quite volatile since. That downward trend has stopped. So there is a risk, and some of the conversation coming out of the Open Market Committee members has been that, well, yeah, maybe we wait a little bit longer. Maybe it wouldn't be June. Maybe it wouldn't even be July, but later on. We still got a rate hike penciled in for June, but there's a lot of uncertainty about that, a lot of risk going along with that that assumption.
But do you think, Steve, it's possible there might not even be a rate cut for this year at all?
I still think that there will be rate cuts sometime in the second half of the year. It's hard to believe that the labor market and the economy in general can continue to grow as fast as it has, given where interest rates are today, and given the fairly broad weakness across much of the global economy, particularly in Europe and in Latin America, not so much here in Asia. So I certainly think that we'll still have some cuts coming in the second half of the year, but exactly when, boy, it's so hard to tell right now.
Are you expecting any other central bank aside from the Federal Reserve, aside from the Philippine Central Bank, any other bank across the world to create some fireworks even before the Fed's next policy decision? I mean, when you look over, the Swiss National Bank was actually the first developed market central bank to cut rates since the crisis. Taiwan also came out with a big surprise.
Very big surprise,
cutting rates.
Yes.
The Bank of Japan hiking for the first time in 17 years. Turkey raised, Brazil cut. What do you think? Are you expecting any more fireworks from other central banks before the big story from the Fed?
Well, if there's any surprise that may come, it possibly could come from the European Central Bank, and that is because inflation has been coming in pretty well in Europe. And the European economy is expanding at a very slow pace. They could certainly use lower interest rates as a bit of a foundation under the economy. So I think that if there is any central bank that might move before the Fed, it might be the European Central Bank.
Could it be this week? Because it meets this week.
I don't think it'll be this week, no. I think it's a bit too soon.
All right. And all of these central bank moves, they have so many, you know, they can affect so many things, including currency. The peso. I wanted to get your take on the peso. Everyone is now watching the Philippine peso. We actually closed last week at 56.50. It's our weakest close in over 2 months, or since our 56.53 per dollar finish in January. What are your thoughts on the peso?
Well, the peso will depend a lot on what happens with interest rates and whether the BSP moves, in a sense, in sync with the Fed. The BSP is not the only central bank that has to be watching this. I think we'll see central banks in Thailand, in Indonesia, in particular, watching very carefully and probably trying to stay close to the pace that the Federal Reserve takes. If you do look, take a little bit of a longer term look, if you look, say, over the past year, the peso has been fairly steady, even though in recent weeks it has gone up. So I'm not too concerned about the peso right now, as long as that interest rate spread with the U.S. doesn't get too wide.
All right. And final question. You did say that, you know, central banks cut rates to help the economy. soldier on, keep churning. Is there a lot of pressure now for the Philippine Central Bank to do just that, to support the economy? Because we did report that, for example, the government did lower the actual GDP numbers from the previous quarters. And they're everyone's expecting the economy to slow down this year and next. Do you see any pressure, massive pressure, on the central bank to cut sooner just to support the economy, or not so much?
I don't see so much pressure. You know, the fourth quarter read on GDP came in a little slower at 5.6% over the year, a little slower than the third quarter. But things seem to be fairly well on track in terms of industrial production, in terms of exports, and the labor market is fairly healthy in the Philippines. You know, we're looking at the Philippine economy growing by just under 6%, 6 to 7% has been the target in the past for the government in the Philippines. May not quite make that, but I think the Philippines will be close. So I don't think there's any huge reason right now why the BSP should have to move immediately. I think they've got a little bit of time to be a little patient.
All right, a little bit more time to be a little bit more patient. On that note, Steve, good to see you. Thank you so much for taking our call, and we look forward to our next conversation. Thank you again.
Thanks so much.
All right. Now, before we go over headlines overseas, we just wanted to bring you this. Pure Gold numbers. Net income for the fourth quarter of 2023 actually dropped by about 30% year on year to just 1.98 billion pesos. The bottom line dropped on increased operating expenses amid store expansions, while the margins also fell because of increased competition. We'll try to bring you the breakdown of those numbers later on in the day, but that's what we're getting from Pure Gold. I wanted to also bring you the updated numbers. We're about 22 minutes into trade for the day. We are widening the losses. The index underperforming, the PSEI down by 0.4%, 28 points. We're at 67.17. Wow, it seems like it's going to be quite a challenge to protect and to defend the 6,700 level, as Adrian said earlier. But we'll see. We still have the rest of the day for that, because we are taking a two-day break tomorrow, Tuesday and Wednesday. So there's going to be a forced pause in whatever selling we may see today. In the meantime, here's a quick look at the flash business headlines from overseas. U.S. Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen moving to advance deteriorating ties between Washington and Beijing. The American official made a four-day visit to China with a goal of persuading Chinese officials to rein in excess production capacity for electric vehicles, solar panels, and other clean energy technology that threaten competing firms in the U.S. Now, during the meetings, the Chinese side also expressed concerns over U.S. trade and investment restrictions aimed at blocking China's access to advanced semiconductors. Still on China, the central bank is setting up a $70 billion relending program to support the country's science and technology sectors. The program will offer loans through 21 banks to small and mid-sized technology companies at an interest rate of 1.75%. The one-year loans can be extended twice for up to a year each time. China's policymakers are seeking to boost liquidity and increase confidence in the world's second biggest economy amid headwinds from a property crisis and tensions with major trading partners. In other news, South Korea grappling with doctor shortage. A report by medical science professor in the country shows over 3,700 patients have died since 2017 after local hospitals refused to provide care due to the lack of physicians. An over six-week national walkout by nearly 13,000 residents and interns protesting a government plan to boost medical school admissions has exacerbated the situation. Protesters assert authorities should focus on improving the pay and working conditions of trainee doctors first instead of recruiting more. The collapsing healthcare has become a major issue in the parliamentary elections set to take place this Wednesday, April 10th. Moving on, Kirin Holdings pushing deeper into healthcare. The Japanese beverage company wants to shore up its recent acquisitions, seeking new opportunities in North America with a goal of reaching $3.3 billion in annual sales. This will make up 20% of the group's total sales. On to more news. Thailand steering an initiative for a joint visa program with countries that hosted about 70 million tourists last year. This in a bid to attract more long-haul and high-spending travelers as the country aims to become an aviation and logistics hub. Other countries that are part of the program include Cambodia, Laos, Malaysia, Myanmar, and Vietnam, taking part in this so-called single visa program. And finally, Boeing involved in another accident. American airline regulators have begun an investigation after an engine cowling on a Boeing 737-800 fell off during takeoff and struck a wing flap. The aircraft had 135 passengers and 6 crew members on board. Luckily, no one was reported injured. The incident comes as Boeing has been in the spotlight in recent times over manufacturing and safety concerns. And before we go, a total solar eclipse will cross North America on April 8, offering millions a rare opportunity to see skies temporarily darken as the moon blots out the sun. And that is going to start along Mexico's Pacific coast, travel across a swath of the U.S. from Texas to Maine, and then into Canada. Here is a breakdown of everything you need to know about the rare celestial event.
Skygazers across North America are in for a treat on April 8 when a total solar eclipse will pass over Mexico, the United States, and Canada. Here's everything you need to know about the rare celestial event. A total solar eclipse occurs when the moon passes between Earth and the sun, completely blocking the face of the sun along a small path of our planet's surface. This is called the path of totality. NASA's research astrophysicist Nicolene Vial.
Some people who are in the path of totality will get to see a total solar eclipse, and that's where the moon totally blocks out the main body of the sun. Those people will get to see the corona, or the atmosphere of the sun, peeking out from around the moon.
According to NASA, the April 8 eclipse will begin over the South Pacific Ocean and will cross North America, passing over Mexico, United States, and Canada. NASA estimates 31.6 million people live in the path of totality this year.
So everybody in the contiguous United States will get to see at least a partial eclipse where the moon partially blocks out the sun. There's a path of totality, though, that starts in Texas and it goes up north and comes out through Maine. And the people in the path of totality will get to see the main body of the sun totally blocked out.
In October 2023, people in parts of North and South America witnessed an annual solar eclipse, which is a slightly different event. The moon passes between the sun and Earth when it's at or near its furthest point from our planet. It doesn't completely cover the face of the sun, leaving what looks like a ring of fire in the sky. Then there's the lunar eclipse, when Earth sits between the moon and the sun, and our planet's shadow is cast upon the moon's surface. The next total solar eclipse will occur in 2026.
Total solar eclipse happens somewhere on the Earth about every 18 months, but of course most of the Earth is water. It's not where people live. And so the fact that so many people live nearby the total eclipse or live in the partial phases of the eclipse, it just means so many more people will get to participate in this event.
And after the April 8 eclipse, the next total solar eclipse that will be visible from the contiguous U.S. will be on August of 2044, 20 years from now. And before we go, for those who tried to guess a blind item, this is the pick of Adrian, UFCL Financial, already up 18% for the year, but still looking at another 20% upside for the rest of the year. This stock is, it's a banking stock, drumroll please. China Banking. Do let us know if you got that. Do tweet us at ANC Alerts. In the meantime, that's it for the show. I'm Michelle Long. Thank you so much for watching. Stay safe and stay with ANC.